Good morning, Westside.
Good morning.
Hey, happy Mother's Day. All right. What a great breakfast. And, man, I'm going to work real hard not to fall asleep while I'm preaching. So you do the same. For those of you who came to our breakfast this morning, thank you so much. Out in the foyer, there's that display. And if you didn't go in there earlier, there's some signs you can hold up. You can take pictures with your family if you'd like. So I encourage you to do that after the service is over this afternoon, and just make some memories with your family, with your mom, and or just a group of people, and have some fun. But let's go to the Lord and pray, and then we'll begin worship. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we come to you, and we are so thankful, Lord, today, especially a day like today, when we can celebrate our moms, and for many of them, the spiritual heritage that they have blessed and instilled with us. We know that not every mom's perfect, Lord. None of them are. But they raised us. They taught us how to live and to work in society. And we just especially thank for them. And Lord, now as we come and we come to a time where we worship together, I just pray, Lord, that we'll be able to put our concerns, our worries to the side, and just focus our heart and our mind on you and worship you for who you are and what you've done for us. Lord, thank you for those that are here in person this morning and for those that are watching online. And we just pray all these things in the powerful name of Jesus. All God's people said,
amen.
Amen. If you'll stand.
Yeah. Good morning. Hello, everybody. Happy Mother's Day to the mothers. We're going to have a good time worshiping this morning, so you go ahead and stand up with us if you're not standing yet. Yeah, here we go.
For I fall, for I ever fall.
may be seated. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this beautiful day that we can come to worship you. We thank you for such a glorious day full of sunshine and the perfect temperature, especially a beautiful day, Father, for us to come and remember all of the mothers here. Such a special gift that you've granted us with such a beautiful gift of mothers, Father, that each one has touched all of our lives, even those that are not their own children. They make such a difference in every day, every walk of our life. The lessons that they've taught, the compassion, they show an example of your undying love, Father. Their love is unconditional, and through them we see your unconditional love for each of us. And we thank you for that gift today, that we can take this one day of the year. We should do it every single day, but on this day especially, Father, to remember and to honor them, to honor the gift that they've given us and the sacrifices they've made for us in their lives. We thank you for this, and we thank you for the gift of your precious Son, as he died upon the cross for our sins. We pray all these things in the name of your Son, Jesus. Amen. Welcome, Westside, those who are here and those who are online. We have just a few announcements to go over. There will be a Senior Adults Bible Study this Thursday at 11 a.m. We also have the ongoing clothing drive, so if you have any extra clothing that you're getting rid of, you can put in bags and in the choir room. So we'll be taking that over to be deposited for those who need it. We also have on May 23rd, which is 2 weeks from today, a graduate recognition day. So if you have a high school or college graduate who's graduated this year, let the office know so that we can put them in and give them proper acknowledgement. We also have the School's Out Bash, which is coming up in June, on June 2nd. That is a Wednesday evening. We will have, instead of having the normal nightly activities, we'll have just a nice cookout, water slide, and just a fun bash and fellowship for everybody to come. And then also be prepared for Vacation Bible School coming up in June and Centrifuge coming up in July. So those are some things just to be aware of as they come up soon. Thank you.
Thank you, if you're visiting with us today, we want to just say welcome to Westside. Thank you so much for being here. In the bulletin, there's a tear-out section right there. And if you would, just as your gift to us, just fill that out, put your name and information there. We promise we won't send the church SWAT team to your house or anything like that. But we just want to have a record of your attendance. And also, on the other side of that is some prayer requests, and that's something I really am passionate about. If there's anything, church members, visitors, anyone at all that you would like prayer about, just feel free to fill that out and write some prayer requests down there and just put that on the offering plate that's passed at the end of the service. And I take that seriously. I pray over those weekly and keep them close to heart. So please feel free to do that. We're glad you're here. So at this time, we're going to just take a few minutes and greet one another and take a few minutes. And after that, Bobby Watkins will come up here and share a quick message for our children. But so at this time, just stand and greet one another in the Lord.
have John.
Another confession to make this morning. Good morning. I can't blame Dave this week. He blessed me last week when he prayed over me, and I appreciate that, brother. All right. Good morning. The Lord has done it again, folks. I keep thinking I'm going to share with you something about favorites and use a box of crayons, but he's changed it again on me this morning. And I'm going to follow his lead. Happy Mother's Day, Mom. Happy Mother's Day to all you mamas and those who are mothers. And that's my message was going to be about someone who wasn't necessarily a mother, but was a mother this morning. And God did this to me this morning, and I'm going to try to get through it. You help me out, all right? But yeah, there's been a lot of us have mothers, or we have a physical mother, Bertha's, but then there's probably a lot of you can speak to someone in your life who's been like a mama to you. Probably looked out for you, whether they were a family, or maybe a neighbor, a friend, someone down the street. But you probably could picture someone in your mind, maybe as you were growing up, or even now, that you might have even looked up to like a mama to you. Well, those of us in the Nash family had one that wasn't a mother, but she was like one to us, and a lot of kids in this church too. I don't know how many of you remember Jean Fuller. Yeah. Well, there was one Mother's Day. The Lord brought it to my mind, and He just said, "Go to this scripture and share about her as we rejoice in our mothers." And I want to go with this story this morning. I think it's important for all of us. My Aunt Jean, she loved kids. She loved us kids and her family. She blessed us every Christmas and birthdays. And if you don't know, she worked for the paper company, and we didn't need school supplies. All you had to do is go to Aunt Jean's house, because she worked for Mead, and you'd get every kind of paper, composition books, or anything you needed from her and Uncle Henry. They had it in their basement. So we'd go shop there every year for school. But there was one Mother's Day, and I don't think she ever looked at herself this way, but we like to bless our mothers on Mother's Day, right? The church, we want to give you a little something, token of how much we love you, appreciate you, but also those that may not necessarily be a mother, but you are a mother to many. And my Aunt Jean was a mother to many, though she wasn't a physical mother. And one particular Mother's Day, she was still up in the choir when the choir was still behind us, and she was sitting up there, and we'd given everything out, she didn't stand up. You know, we say stand up moms, you know, to acknowledge them, and she didn't stand up, and I guess nobody caught it, but a little old guy sitting back there caught it, and he got up and moseyed up here and grabbed her gift and took it up to her. That was my Uncle Henry. And he knew what she did and what she does and what she did for him first and foremost, and how she loved him, but how much she was a mother to us and how much she was a mother. She was very famous on Wednesday nights. We'd get here on a Sunday night. She'd come in with that little hand and she'd say, "Here, take that. Don't tell Henry now." And there'd be, and it wasn't $5. It was pretty significant what she had handed you. There may be others that she may have slid a little greenery to you, but she wanted to help, pay for pizza or whatever. But she epitomized the love of Christ. She did, truly. She loved family, her nieces and nephews, her brothers and sisters. She aggravated her brothers, but she loved them. And she loved us. And I just thought of her this morning and others that may not be a physical mother. And Mother's Day may be tough for you. Or maybe if you've lost your mom, sometimes it's not easy. But my Aunt Jean loved us very much, and I remember that Sunday when Uncle Henry, I don't remember where he was sitting, but you could have heard a pin drop if I remember correctly, and correct me if I'm wrong, but I knew what he was doing when he got up. He just walked up there and got that, I think it was a flower or something, marched up there and he handed that to her, and it was just precious. But she was a great aunt and mother to a lot of us, and I'm going to read these verses because it reminds me of her. This is how we know what love is. Jesus Christ laid down his life for us, and we ought to lay down our lives for our brothers. If anyone has material possessions and sees his brother in need but has no pity on him, how can the love of God be in him? Verse 18 is important. Dear children, let us not love with words or tongue, but with actions and truth. Now, it's not that we don't want to tell each other we love each other, right? We love. It's important we love each other. But actions and truth speak monumentally. And as I speak to everybody, I guess I'm saying this to the crowd, but boys and girls, and there's going to be people in your life that you have a mom, but there's going to be folks that it may not be a mom, it may be a father figure, or an uncle or aunt or a neighbor or grandmama, granddaddy, or whoever that might love you like Aunt Jean. And my prayer would be, if someone loves you like Aunt Jean, you're going to be all right.
Amen.
All right. Happy Mother's Day. Let's pray. Father in heaven, Lord, thank you so much for who you are in our lives. And Jesus, how you use people to show the love of Christ. And that's what you call all of us to do, Lord. It was not just for my Aunt Jean. But Lord, how you used her. And now she didn't get to be a mother for whatever reason. But she mothered many of us. Family, church family, neighbors and friends, Lord. And I'm thankful for her this morning. Thank you for my own mom. Thank you for all the mothers that are here. I thank you for my wife, who is a tremendous mother to our kids. And Lord, may you bless each one, those that may have be missing their moms today, may not can be close to them, or whatever the case, Lord. Father, thank you for our mothers. I thank you for my Aunt Jean, and thank you most of all, Jesus, for who you are in our lives, and we ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you, Bobby. This time, we want to recognize our mothers, and I'm going to need some help in just a minute from the students, if you'll help kind of pass out some things. You know, the old saying is that, you know, moms love, what is it, jewelry, chocolate, and flowers, right? So we were discussing this week. I was like, okay, I can get a diamond tennis bracelet, we can get them a rose, and some chocolate. Well, Phoebe and Matt overruled me, like, I don't know if our budget can do that. I was going to try. No, that's okay. We were fiscally responsible. But if you're a mother, if you would just stand at this time, and let's give all these moms an applause. Thank you. All right. Amen. We have students, if you'll come forward, there's some chocolate up here, and there's a rose. The red roses are for the moms, and the pink roses are for the ladies who are not moms. So we want to give that to all the ladies if they would like a flower. So yeah, y'all just come on up, and ladies, you just remain standing until you get some chocolate and some flowers. I'm sorry about that diamond tennis bracelet. We said we'll just do the breakfast this morning instead. So I know it's not, yeah. But we're so thankful for you and how you raised your children and your husbands in some cases. No, but being honest, okay. but. Once you get a candy bar and a flower, yeah, you guys can just take them around. You can have a seat, but thank you so much. And if you don't like the candy bar, you can maybe swap afterwards or something and find something you like. Or if you need to make some attention, if you're missing something, just to let some of the students know. All right. Thank you, students.
Oh, thank you, dear. So sweet.
I still see a few people standing that might need chocolate or a rose. Yeah, it's all good. Well, I just want to pray for you as moms and as families, and then we'll continue worship. But let's go to the Lord in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we just come to you, and Lord, again, we are so thankful for those mothers who raised us, who not only taught us about just life skills and schoolwork, but also taught us how to live following the Lord. And Lord, especially for those moms, and for those moms that might be here today that maybe are not a physical mom, but they have raised children themselves. They have adopted children and brought them under their wings and helped them out. Lord, we're thankful for them as well. Lord, I just pray a special blessing on them today. May they have a great time, whether they spend it quietly by themselves, relaxing today, or they spend time with family, celebrating, and just talking with one another. Lord, we just pray a special blessing on them. Thank you, God, for our mothers, and we pray these things. In Jesus' name we pray. All God's people said, amen. Amen.
All right, guys. Thank you again. To all the mothers, we love you. So we're going to go ahead and stand back up and continue worshiping, okay? Yeah.
Thank you.
God, thank you so much for this day, this Mother's Day, that we get to celebrate the mothers that just exhibit so much love that you have for us, God. And thank you for that love and for them in our lives and for the influence that they've had. And God, thank you for Jesus and for the love and mercy and grace that he has given to each and every one of us every day. We pray that we can open up our hearts and continue to learn something today in the ceremony, God, and that we can just lay our burdens down and come to you, God. And take rest in you. We love you, God, and we pray these things in your name only, in the name of Jesus, amen. All right. You guys may be seated. Thank you.
I'm sorry. Oh, man, that was great worship. And great food, great worship. I'm ready to go to sleep. So, oh, man. All right. Yeah, if you need to stand up and stretch, feel free to do that. Yeah. Whatever you do, you know, jumping jacks, cartwheels down the... No. So, awesome. Good stuff. Thank you, praise team. All right. Some of you are new here this week, and you're a guest. So, again, welcome to Westside, and we're in our second week of a new series. We're calling Because You Asked. Several months ago, we put a suggestion box out in the foyer, and we said, "Hey, if there's any topics or any questions you have about the Bible or about culture, feel free to write down any kind of question or any topic and put it in that box." And so, you did that for about 2 months, and then we took those suggestions, those questions, and went to the church council, and we came up with the top five, and we're looking at some things because you asked. So last week we kind of answered several questions that kind of dealt around sin, and we looked at that. In the next couple of weeks, if you want to see what are you talking about, the next one right out in the foyer. In the hallway there, behind the sound booth, is a list of the different topics, so you can see that. We'll be talking about social justice. What does the Bible say about that? We'll be looking at is the Bible racist and sexist and against women, all these different things. And then, so just if you want to check that out. But today, I think it's a good segue. Last week we talked about sin, and several questions that you submitted. Also kind of dealt with salvation. So we go from sin to salvation here. Where sin begins with man, salvation begins with God, right? Amen. You know, there is nothing that we can do to earn our salvation, not of works. So we look at that. So there were two questions in particular, and you've got the outline there in the bulletin. You can kind of follow along with that. But Jonah 2:9 says that salvation comes from the Lord. And what mankind excels in, sin, God over and excels in. He can overcome any kind of sin. So that's good news. That's hope for you and I. So, but we're going to look at these two questions that were asked. But before I do that, I felt like it was a good idea to kind of just go over the basics of salvation. What does it entail? What are the different pieces of salvation? And I think it's important because when we come to answer the questions that were asked, we need to remind ourselves, this is what salvation is. This is what salvation is not. And so if you'll kind of quickly flip with me a little bit here, the very first thing there says, the basic salvation, there it says the method of salvation is grace. Right? And you may be familiar with Ephesians 2:8. It says, "For by grace are you saved through faith, not of yourselves." That is a grace gift. And another passage I want to point you to is Romans chapter 3, where it talks about grace. Romans chapter 3, starting in verse 21. It says, "But now a righteousness from God, apart from the law, has been made known, which the law and the prophets testify, the righteousness from God comes through faith in Jesus Christ to all who believe. There is no difference, for we have all sinned and fallen short of the glory of God, and are justified freely by his grace through the redemption that came by Christ Jesus. So that's familiar to you there. So salvation is a grace gift. Now that sometimes that's a stumbling block for many people. So many times we think we have to earn it. We've got to work to do something to attain salvation. And I believe that Christianity is the only religion, only worldview that says, no, it's a grace gift. It's freely given. So the second thing about salvation, the condition of salvation is faith. God, again, he does everything for salvation. He provides it. God took the first steps. He moved first in salvation. But the only condition that we have as his creation, as his people, is for us to accept it by faith. That is our only thing. It's not a work. Look at John 3, verse 18. It says, whoever believes in him is not condemned, but whoever does not believe stands condemned already because he has not believed in the name of God's one and only Son. That may be familiar to you. A famous passage is Romans chapter 10. Many of you who grew up memorizing the Roman road and you use those scriptures to share the gospel with, I love verses 9 through 13. Romans 10, 9 through 13. It says that if you confess with your mouth Jesus is Lord, and if you believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For it is with your heart that you are that you believe and are justified, and it is with your mouth that you confess and are saved. As the scripture says, anyone who trusts in him will never be put to shame, for there is no difference between Jews and Gentiles. The same Lord is Lord of all and richly blesses all who call on him, for everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. So there we see that scripture again, and again you can talk about Ephesians 2 and 8 and 9. It says, for by grace are you saved through faith, that not of yourselves, it is the gift of God. Verse 9 says that not of works, so that no one can boast. And that leads to our third point there. Works are not required for salvation, but they are an evidence. There's this big debate, you know. Some people like to say, well, the Bible contradicts itself. Paul says it's all by grace, but in the book of James, he's talking about works. And you have to understand how you need to look at the book of James. This is the half-brother of Jesus who wrote that letter. James is not talking about a works-based salvation. He's talking about that works are the evidence of your salvation that flow naturally out after you have a relationship with Christ. Look at James 2:18 there. He says, but someone will say, you have faith, I have deeds. Show me your faith without deeds, and I will show you my faith by what I do. So that is the evidence of salvation is the actions, our deeds, our the things we say, the attitudes that we envelop in life, and our deeds are the evidence of our salvation. And then the whole book of 1 John is just great. I know it's a short book there, but I just want to look at it real quick. 1 John chapter 2, just the first couple of verses there, 1 through 5, 1 through 6. It says this. It says that, my dear children, I write this to you so that you will not sin. But if anyone does sin, we have one who speaks to the Father in our defense, Jesus Christ, the righteous one. He is the atoning sacrifice for our sins, and not only for our sins, but the sins of the whole world. We know that we have come to know him if we obey his commands. That's the key right there in verse 3. We know that we have come to know him if we obey his commands. The man who says, I know him, but does not do what he commands is a liar, and the truth is not in him. So tell us how you really feel, James. You're a liar. So yeah, I think he was listening to Jesus when Jesus really gave it to the Pharisees and religious leaders there. But so again, works are not a requirement for salvation, but they are an evidence. So, and then the final point about salvation that I think we need to understand is that we can have assurance. The confidence in salvation is assurance. We can have assurance that we have eternal life. I love 1 John 5:13. It says, these things have I written to you so that you may know that you have eternal life. God doesn't want us to live in doubt. He doesn't want us to say, well, I hope I'll go to heaven. I think I'm going to go to heaven. He says, I want you to know that you go to heaven. So he gives us that assurance. The great passage in Romans 8, let me read that to you. It says that for who shall separate us from the love of Christ, there, verse 35, shall trouble or hardship or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword? No, and then you skip down to verse 37, no, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels or demons, neither the present or the future, nor the powers, neither height nor depth, nor anything in all creation will separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. So we can have assurance. We don't have to live in doubt. For those of us who put faith in him, we accept his grace gift, and we know that it's not by works, but we can fully trust that we are saved, and we can know that. So that's some basic stuff. And I'll tell you, when I came to these questions today, man, it was tough. I told Matt I felt like a ping pong ball with some different thoughts, and I was, oh, this is good, oh, I like this, and I kind of bounced back and forth. And we're going to look at these two questions here. But I want to tell you, just because I'm a pastor, I don't know it all. I don't understand everything. There are things that I have looked at, I've dug into scriptures, and I've really examined them. And I'm going to give you what the Lord has shown me the best of, like right now, today. You know, who's to say that a year down the road or something else that God might show something else to me? And he said, oh, okay. You know, but I just want to make that point. As we look at these different questions, because you asked, please know that, hey, I'm giving you what I believe is biblical, but I'm open for you to come knock on my door anytime, give me a phone call and say, hey, you know that point you made? What about this? And you can share something with me. You can say, what do you think about this? And we can talk about it. I'm open to that. The subject that we're going to look at today was salvation. Salvation is an important doctrine, but the questions we're going to look at today, I believe, are not essential questions. If you find yourself agreeing with me or disagreeing with what I'm going to share with you today, that's completely okay. The things we're going to look at today, these are non-essentials. These are secondary things. So you may say, well, I disagree with you, Pastor John. That's okay. And we can still be friends and have barbecue and have fun time. But, you know, that's okay. These things are what I believe are non-essential doctrines, okay? We have the right things that are essential. We focus on those. Some of these questions that were asked, I'm like, wow, this is a good question. This is some good information. So I just want to kind of say that to you up front, you know. And the very first question there on the outline, it says, do lukewarm Christians go to heaven? Somebody put that in. Do lukewarm Christians go to heaven? Well, I think the very first place you need to start is you need to define some terms. You need to say, okay, what's the definition of Christian? What are we talking about here? What do you mean if you ask that question? What do you mean by Christian? And what do you mean by lukewarm? So, you know, we can look at, do you mean by Christian somebody who was raised by Christian parents and they maybe went to church occasionally? Some people think that's what it is to be a Christian. Or do you mean maybe somebody who attends a Christian church regularly? Oh, well, they're a Christian. Or when you say the word Christian, do you mean someone who believes and puts their faith and trust in Jesus Christ and he covered their sins and they attempt to follow him the best way they know how? All right? When I see that question, I think, especially if that conversation might come up with you at work with somebody or just in a casual conversation, when somebody asks a question like that, the thing you need to do is you need to say, okay, what do you mean by Christian? What do you mean by lukewarm? That's a great place to start. So a lot of people have different ideas about what things are, but for me, I say someone who's a Christian is not just somebody who sits in the church pew and goes to a Christian church, or someone who's a Christian is not just someone who was raised in a Christian family or household. Someone who is a bona fide follower of Christ, a Christian, is somebody who has placed their faith, their trust in Jesus Christ, and they are attempting to follow him the very best way they can. They're not perfect, again, because we all fall short, the scripture we just read. So that's, you know, one thing we have to look at. And again, the other question, what do you mean by lukewarm? Is that somebody who's just an average good person on average, and maybe they, you know, they don't really exercise their faith, they don't practice anything about their Christianity, but they might believe in Jesus and they might believe that God exists? Or do you mean lukewarm, maybe in the way that it talks about in Revelation chapter 3, where God says, because you are lukewarm, I'm going to spew you out of my mouth? There's a lot of, you know, again, if you have this conversation with somebody, I think the very first thing to do is figure out, okay, well, what do you mean by that? You know, that's a great question to ask. So here are a few thoughts about that. Let me just give you a couple of scriptures, because that's worth more than my thoughts. But the first one I want to point you to is in 1 Corinthians chapter 3. You know, the book of Corinthians is great. Paul addressed the Christians in Corinth. Here. And if you know anything about the book of Corinthians, you know the Corinthians had a lot of problems, didn't they? Especially chapter 5 and 6. It gets kind of weird. I'm just saying. But these Christians, Paul describes them there in Corinthians chapter 3, verses 1 through 4. He describes them as carnal Christians or worldly Christians. Let me read to you just a couple of verses in 1 Corinthians 3 and let you get an idea, because I think you'll make a connection here. He says, brothers, again, brothers, Christian brothers. Brothers, I could not address you as spiritual, but as worldly, mere infants in Christ. I gave you milk, not solid food, for you were not ready for it. Indeed, you are still not ready. You are still worldly, for since there is jealousy and quarreling among you, are you not worldly? Are you not acting like mere men? For one says, I follow Paul. The other says, I follow Apollos. Are you not mere men? And he goes on there. So what happened? These Corinthian believers were arguing. They were like, well, you know, Paul's my favorite disciple. He came and, you know, he was really cool and I liked his haircut or whatever, you know. And so they're arguing about, like, who their favorite missionary was that came to Corinth. And some are like, well, I like Apollos because that's a cool name. And did you see his thighs? They were really big. I don't know, whatever. So yeah, I'm trying to keep you guys awake. So anyway, so they're having this discussion. Paul writes them back. He's like, hey, that's worldly talk. That's infant stuff. You guys are acting like a bunch of babies. And then Paul kind of goes into chapter 3 there. He's talking about building a spiritual house. You know, he says, you're built up. And he uses the illustration of building with different materials. He says, some of you build with gold, silver, costly stones. He said, but some of you, you're building with wood, hay, and sticks, you know. And he's just like, he says, and listen, let me go to verse 10 here in Corinthians. He says, by the grace God has given me, I laid a foundation as an expert builder, and not someone else who's, now someone else is building on it. But each one should be careful how he builds, for no one can lay any foundation other than the one already laid, which is Christ Jesus. If a man builds on his foundation using gold, silver, costly stones, wood, hay, straw, his work will be shown for what it is, because the day will bring it to light. It will be revealed with fire, and the fire will test the quality of each man's work. If what he has built survives, he will receive his reward. If it is burned up, he will suffer loss. He himself will be saved, but only as one escaping through the flames. So that passage right there, he's addressing this. Hey, what if we've got people that are acting like a bunch of crazy baby Christians, and they're not living like Paul and Apollos and all them taught? He says, so Paul's like, hey, they'll be saved, but it'll be like going through the fire, that, you know, they're still worldly, but they will be saved, but that's the only thing they're going to have left is their salvation. Everything else that they could have done for the Lord is going to be burned up because it wasn't any good. And I think that's a key point to see there. So, you know, so I ask us this morning, what are you and I building with? Are we building with the good quality stuff? I know the materials right now is like five times what it normally is. If you go to Home Depot and you want to buy a 2x4, it'll cost you $35. But what are we building with when it comes to our faith? Are we spending the time? Are we taking the toll and really using good quality material? Or are we just doing, oh, whatever, I'll just give Jesus my leftovers? I think God wants our best, and it'll not only be for our benefit, but maybe for the benefit of others around us too as well. You know, last week we talked about that there were different types of judgments, right? Some, you know, the scripture there and the parables that Jesus taught, that some will be beaten with more blows and some with less. It's the same thing when it comes to heaven and rewards. There are some that will receive more rewards than others because someone believes, they've put their faith and trust in the Lord, but they have not built their faith, their Christian walk, with costly stones. And the things that they're doing are maybe worldly and all that, according to Paul, that's going to be burned up. So it's so important for us to build with those good quality materials there. Verse 15 is key. He himself will be saved, but only as one escaping through the flames. Next scripture I want to show you there is Ephesians chapter 4, verse 30. If you'll flip there real quick. Ephesians 4:30. You know, Paul warns the believers here in Ephesus to not grieve the Holy Spirit. Let me read this to you, starting in verse, back up to 29. Do not let any unwholesome talk come out of your mouths, but only what is helpful for building up others according to their needs, that is, they may benefit those who listen. And do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, with whom you were sealed for the day of redemption. So that verse right there says that, hey, you were sealed. Your belief seals you. You have that assurance of salvation. But don't take it as an excuse to go live how you want to live. Don't burden the Holy Spirit. And so I think that's so important for us to remember that we were sealed. And then the last point there before we move on to the next question here is, clearly there is a difference between having faith and being faithful, right? We can have faith and we can believe in the Lord Jesus Christ and we can put our trust in him, but it's a whole other thing that sometimes we are faithful. Less. Sometimes we're faithful. We all have those times where we're not living like we should. I do. there are times, man, it's like I feel like I'm spinning plates sometimes. Man, I'll get my prayer life going good and my Bible reading kind of and so, oh no, I need to focus more on my Bible reading. So I'll do that and my prayer life goes down. from time to time, we experience those ups and downs in our faith. But just because we may be in a down place or we have not been practicing those spiritual disciplines does not mean, if you, again, go to the definition of what a true Christian is, someone who puts their faith and trust in Jesus Christ, accepts that free gift, they're still saved. Paul talks about that. There's just some thoughts there. Something to think about. And again, you can I'll be glad to connect with you if you want to talk about something. Well, what about this? What about, there's so many things we can look at. We just don't have the time this morning. But the second question here, this one, man, I went back and forth like a ping pong ball with several things here. And I'm just going to give you what I think is what I fully understand about salvation here. But someone also asked this question, can we lose our salvation? This is kind of similar to lukewarm Christians go to heaven. But can we lose our salvation? Somebody asked. Again, I think you have to start asking questions. Lose my salvation in what sense? Like I lose my car keys? No. you can't lose it like that. Or do you mean, can I lose my salvation because I'm not living for the Lord? Or I'm not following him? And maybe I've turned away, or maybe and I know someone who started out on fire for the Lord, and they had a number of years where they followed Christ, but then 5-10 years down the road, they don't want anything to do with the Lord Jesus or faith. I think that's a big question to ask. So, I don't know all the answers. I'm going to give you what I feel like is Scripture is telling me this week in the 2 or 3 days that I had to prepare this week because of everything going on with graduation and food drive and all that stuff. But again, we can talk about this. But here's some thoughts that I want you to consider. Going back to what we talked about the basics of salvation, if you can't earn your salvation by works, I don't think you can lose it by works either. If it's a grace gift, it's a gift. If you cannot earn your salvation by doing something, you can't lose it by doing something either. That would be awful. That would be, you'd have to be a perfectionist. Everything that you do, you'd have to have fessed up. Because you'd have to like ask the question, well, at what point do I say, oh man, I've got this unconfessed sin that I did like 3 days ago and I forgot about it. What if I die? You know, and there's just this whole thing we're going to look at here in just a minute, a scenario that I think will make more sense. But that's a first thought there, you know. But maybe the person who put this question in, maybe they were saying, but can a person turn away from the Lord? Can they stop believing? Can they stop following Jesus Christ? And I'll tell you, from the best of my knowledge at looking at the scriptures this week, I have to say, yeah, I think that's a possibility. But we'll talk about it here in just a minute. What does that mean? I thought you believed in eternal security, John. I do. We're going to talk about that in just a minute. But I'll get to that. I'm sorry, I'm jumping ahead of myself. I believe this is a good... if you will, turn to Romans chapter 11. We were just in our Bible study class in this passage just a few weeks ago, and I believe it's got some great insight for us scripturally about salvation. Romans chapter 11, verses 20 through 23. Look at this passage here. It says, as soon as I find that small letter. Here, granted... But they were broken off because of unbelief. They, talking about the Jewish people, they were broken off because of unbelief, because of their unbelief, and, excuse me, I'm, there you go. Granted, they were broken off because of their unbelief, and you stand by faith. Do not be arrogant, but be afraid, for if God did not spare the natural branches, he will not spare you either. Consider, therefore, the kindness and sternness of God stems for those who fell, but kindness to you, provided that you continue in his kindness. Otherwise, you also will be cut off, and if they do not persist in unbelief, they will be grafted in. For God is able to graft them in again after all. I don't know, stop right there. This passage in the middle of Romans here, I mean, that's deep stuff too. In Romans, Paul's really talking about Israel, past, present, and future there. But just a couple of things. Paul talks about the Jewish people. They were chosen by God to be the chosen race. He said some of them were cut off. He says, and you Gentile believers, you were grafted in. There, and he says right there in verse 22, he says, but who's to say that they, being pruned and cut off, they cannot be grafted back in again by the Lord? And he's basically saying, hey, we have to maintain our salvation. Now, when I say maintain our salvation, I don't mean in any kind of works way. Okay, again, salvation is not by works, but we have to maintain that belief and that fellowship and that relationship we have with God in order to keep it. I think that is key. You know, think about this, the Old Testament, okay? I was looking for examples from Scripture. The Old Testament, there are no Baal worshipers in heaven, right? Even though the Jews were God's chosen people, some of them chose to worship and serve other gods, Baal or all these other crazy ones. And those people will not be in heaven. Only those who love and worship Yahweh, God. And so we have to maintain that. We have to keep that. Really digging into this, I think I can kind of put it, this one phrase in your notes there. I think this is where I finally land. I believe in eternal security. And here's the statement I want to make. This is where I'm at right now today. All right. If you believe, you are eternally secure. If you don't believe, you're not. That's where I'm at. If you believe, you have eternal security because there's nothing you can do to lose it, not by works. But if you don't believe, you're not. You know, and again, the whole debate, we got Calvin and Arminius and all these different, Wesley, all these people. I want to try to be as true as I can to Scripture and not worry about following some of these other theologians from several hundred years ago. I feel like that's where we need to go. And if you believe, you have eternal security. If you don't, you're not. We have to continue. We have to work on that. We have to maintain that. Colossians 1:23 says that if you continue in your faith, then you will have eternal life there. You know, think about it. Here's an example, okay? Think about it. You give your life to Christ, maybe at a younger age. And as you get older, you stop believing, or you stop attending church, or you go do something else. How crazy would it be that says, you know what? For God to force you into heaven, if you changed your mind and you didn't want to go to heaven. No. I'm sorry, John, because you were 13, you gave your life to Christ, and you are going to go to heaven now. That's your only choice. I'm sorry. You know, even though you spent most of your adult life living as an atheist or another religion or worldview or something. I'm sorry, because you made that one decision when you were 13, you're automatically going to go to heaven. See how crazy that would be? And people do that all the time. You know, I mentioned this a couple of times. I think we, sometimes as Baptists, we emphasize, if you just say this prayer, and you just pray these words, and you do that, then you'll be saved. Well, you might have just had an emotional decision. You might have had when the worship was amazing, you're like, oh, yes. But then you walk out of here, and you never follow the Lord. You never are obedient to his teachings, and nothing changes in your life. And to that I would say, were you really, truly saved? And that's the whole debate. We can talk about that. Wait a minute, I thought you believe in eternal security, John. I do. For those who believe, they are secure. But hey, I don't know what people go through, and what, you know, it would be crazy to say, well, I prayed this prayer when I was 9 or 13, and I'm gonna go to heaven, now I can live and do what I want. And live against God's word. You know, that's not what Scripture teaches. You know, one of the verses in Matthew 7, we'll wrap this up, land this plane, but Matthew 7, Jesus, he talks about, he says, you know, many will say to me on that day, Lord, Lord, didn't we not prophesy your name? In your name, drive out demons and perform many miracles. And he says, then I will tell them plainly, I never knew you. Away from me. You see, some people may have a brief experience with their faith. I tell you, as a youth pastor for 23 years, I saw a lot of kids come in, and I saw a lot of kids go out. And I'm telling you, parents, moms today, Mother's Day, if you want your children to stay in church, you go to church with them. You don't send them to church and say, all right, go have fun, go learn about the basic salvation, because that, it won't stick. I'm telling you, in all my experience in 23 years of student ministry, if you want children to stay in the church and not just go for a time, you model it before them. That's so key. That is so key. But that phrase right there, I never knew you. I mean, people might think they had a salvation moment. Oh, I went to this camp and I got all emotional. We were all crying and whatever, but there was no change. And I think Jesus would say, I never knew you. You got emotional, and emotions are good. God gives them to us, but we can't be fully emotional all the time. We have to think about our salvation. It's a, you know, Jesus said to love your God, the Lord your God, with all your heart, soul, and mind. That's all those areas. We have to love God with our mind as much as we love him with our heart. That's all of those areas. So as we close up this morning, you know, as we kind of wrap up, and I want to come down, this is a lot of information. And again, I believe this is something that is not a essential. We can have a difference on this. We can still have fellowship, and we're totally fine. This is kind of like the different theories about creation. There's 5 or 6 different theories about creation. We can differ on those things, and it doesn't matter. I feel that way about some of these issues about salvation. You may feel differently, but I just have some questions for you, you know, this morning. Do you believe this morning? All right, have you confessed? Have you given your life to Christ before? Again, it's not just a mantra or a prayer that you pray, but have you really chosen to live for the Lord the best way you can, to follow him? Or have you thought about, well, being a Christian is just about going to church and singing the songs? But there's a point, according to Romans 10:13, it says, whoever calls upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. There's got to be a time in our life, maybe you can't remember it, maybe some of you were much younger, and you're like, I can't remember the day, but I remember kind of how old I was or where I was at. But I believe Scripture teaches that we have to say at some point, man, Lord, I believe that you died on the cross for my sins. I believe that your death paid for my sins and gives me hope for eternal life. You know, and for maybe some of you here today, maybe you already have a relationship with Christ. I just want to ask and challenge you, are you maintaining your faith? Or have you kind of let things go? Have you allowed the fire that God put within you to kind of die down a little bit? And I just want to encourage you this morning, wherever you're at, man, God wants to use you so much for His purposes and His glory. But it's up to us. It's a decision that we have to make. So this morning when we come to the altar is open. You're welcome to come down and pray for yourself or maybe a family member. Maybe you just want to pray for your mother this morning, a family member, and just bless them. Maybe today you realize I need to begin a relationship with Christ. I'll walk you through that in just a minute. For others of you, maybe you want to join the church. Maybe you want to follow through and be obedient to Jesus by having believers' baptism. Maybe you've already put your faith and trust in Christ, but you've never been baptized. What is the Lord speaking to you about this morning? Let me just ask everybody to close your eyes, bow your heads. If you're here this morning, you can hear my voice. If you would like to ask Jesus Christ to come into your life to change it from the inside out, and you can do that. And again, I want to help you do that by offering a prayer. But it's not just repeating this prayer that gives you eternal life. It is living and changing your life. That's what repentance is. It's turning and living differently, living for the Lord and not living for yourself or for a spouse or for family. If you're here this morning and you want to ask Christ to come to your life, you can do something like this. Say a prayer. Say something like this. Dear God, I know that you love me, and I know that I'm a sinner. This morning, God, I want to put my faith in you. I want to accept that free gift, that grace gift of eternal life. Come into my life. Help me live for you, not just today, but every day. Thank you for saving me. In Jesus' name, amen. This morning, if you prayed that prayer, I'd love to just come down and shake your hand and kind of help you following your next step as you are a new believer, a new babe in Christ. Others of you, the altar is open. You want to come down and pray about something. You want to join the church. You want to step forward and say, I need to be baptized. You can do that today. So let's pray, and then I'll turn it over to Rebecca. Dear God, this is your time. This is your Holy Spirit's time to move and to speak to our hearts. Lord, I pray that you will use this time. Help us to be obedient to you. In Jesus' name, amen. Impress on our hearts, Lord, what we need to do to be obedient and to follow you. Lord, I just pray now as we come to this time where we give our tithes and offerings back to you. Lord, you own it all. everything is yours. And Lord, you have blessed us in so many ways as a church. And we're just so grateful and we're so thankful. Lord, I pray today as the offerings are given that you take it, you'll multiply it like you did the fish and the bread, and you'll use it for your kingdom work. Thank you, God. Thank you so much. And we pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. While they're passing the plate, just want to remind you that there is no evening Bible study tonight, no activities. So you take that time, enjoy that with your families, take a nap, whatever you want to do. But we're so glad you came with us. If you are visiting with us, our deacons and staff want to give you a gift before you leave. Just a way to say thank you for visiting with us today. If you're a first-time guest and you've not received that, make sure you see either Matt or one of the guys before you leave. They may find you. So. It's not leftover. Yeah. Speaking of leftover food, if there's anything left that you want to take home, please, please do that. Speak for the bacon. Take all you want. Don't forget to go into the multi-purpose room. Take some pictures with your family if you want. We've got a little backdrop there with some signs. But thank you so much, and happy Mother's Day.
Compare.